I could sit and listen to cello music all day long, with the piano or organ playing in the background. What an awesome gift and talent. Thank you. She drove all the way from Del Rio to be able to play that for us. She brought Jeremy with her. That's awesome. These last many weeks, I have been preaching on the providence of God. Once again, we'll be in Romans chapter 8, verse 28. Now, I'm going to explain a little bit more why that passage is so important. Then I'm going to take you back to the Old Testament, because we can see just so clearly in the Old Testament how God's providence worked, not just in a period of about 90 years, but in a period of hundreds of years. And when we look at that, we can see His hand moving consistently through time, and we see His providence guiding His people. Who are we today, some 2,000 years after the advent of Christ, who are we today to even think for even a moment that the providence of God isn't applicable and still just as powerful as it was then? Just checking. Nobody meant that. Remember what we said a couple of weeks ago? I have to keep repeating it and repeating it until you get it. Amen is your way of telling me that you got it, okay?
Amen.
We'll probably be on the providence of God for the next 10 years. You know, in these weeks we've been talking about, we started off by pointing out the fact that if we got what we deserved, we would all be dead. Because of sin. God has made it clear throughout His Word that sin is not something that He tolerates from the standpoint of being with Him. Adam and Eve learned that lesson after they had been told, don't. They did. And ever since then, we people have believed that we can have some equality with God. And the only thing that we can hope for and the only thing that can bring us to a place of even being able to stand before Him, not equally, but to stand before Him as His child, is the blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And nothing else. When we see this and we look at providence, the reason I keep going back and using this passage in Romans is because this one passage encompasses everything out of the Old Testament and everything into the New Testament and everything into today and into the future. It is one of the most compact statements of the providence of God written by a man who was living and believing and understanding what he could of the providence of God as he went from place to place, whether he was received or he was rejected, whether he was beaten, imprisoned, or whether he was just ushered out of town or even stoned. He believed in the providence of God because he had the wonderful examples of the Old Testament. And as he writes this most powerful letter to the Romans, he puts right in the middle of the book of Romans, he puts this providential statement that covers everything. You know, when people come and they say, I've got these kind of problems and problems and problems and problems, and then you just give them the answer, Jesus. And they're looking at you kind of cross-eyed like, how did that help me? Well, I have to tell you, this verse explains it very well. Because God is working all of these things together. I had someone just this last week, and I want to address this, because they were taking a view of fatalism, which is to say, all the decisions are already made for me. And therefore, if all the decisions and God knows everything that's going to happen, why do I need to do anything? That's called fatalism. The problem with it is that God can't sin. Amen?
Amen.
God can't make you sin. Amen?
Amen.
Do you sin?
Yes.
Therefore, you have choice. If you have choice, God gave that to you through His providence, and you are responsible.
Amen.
You got that? See how it works? It isn't about fatalism. It's about you understanding you have a choice. Because if we say that God is God and all your choices are made for you, and you sin, that means that God chose for you to sin. That means God condoned your sin. ain't happening. That's why fatalism doesn't work, and that's why I would say that to you and share that with you. Let's go back and be reminded, providence means is a means by which God directs all things, seen and unseen, good and evil, toward a worthy purpose, which means His will always prevails. It encompasses chance, luck, destiny, accidents, sickness, pain, suffering, evil, good, life, death, creation, and eternity. God's sovereign control of everything, exercised not only through the miraculous things that He does, but in ordering all the complex natural events so that they accomplish His will. You may be saying, that definition gets bigger every week. You're right, it is. Because it has multiple facets that we can't grab the whole of. But when we start to get the idea that we're here by His mercy, remember that? And whether you're saved or lost, you are here by God's mercy. Because if we got what we should have gotten back in the Garden of Eden when they sinned, we shouldn't be here. Therefore, if we are here, we're here only by the mercy of God. You got that? Good. Now then, when you accept Jesus Christ, we understand the fullness not only of His mercy, but we also understand the fullness of His grace. When you put His mercy and His grace together, that's our life. That's what He's afforded to us. Would you please stand for the reading of God's Word? Romans chapter 8, verse 28. And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. Father, I pray that as we illuminate more of this week, as we speak about it, Lord, as You have shared this week and study all the things that You would have me to say, I pray, Lord, I would be succinct with what's Yours. That, Lord, I would be direct, Father, for Your sake. Father, that I would be able to communicate all that You have in these passages today. That, Lord, we may understand more and more about You. And I pray it all in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, and you may be seated. I'm learning over a lot of years of ministry that I learn constantly about the things of God. I would never stand in this pulpit and say, I got it. About the things that are providential, I have to tell you, I've had the same questions that you've had when it comes to the things that we see in the Old Testament. Why did God let this happen? Why did God do this? And why did God do this? And why did God do this? And you know what? Most of the time, those questions that we have go unanswered because we never crack open His Word and take a look and see and ask God to reveal to us those things. We would just rather go through life ignorant about God. Part of the reason I'm sharing these passages on providence and the reason that I'm preaching about these things is because understanding that God is an agent. He's not someone, he's not what the deists believe. They believe that He just wound up the cosmic clock and one day the alarm's going to go off and He's going to come back. But until then, He's just kind of sitting watching everything that's going on. It's so cool that our God is interactive with our lives. Amen. He wants to be. He wants it to be relational. That's why He sent His Son. That's why He walked in the garden with Adam and Eve. He wanted it to be relational. His creation choosing to see Him as God and sovereign above everything. As I learn these things, I'm reminded of the passage over in Jeremiah that these things come fresh as mercy and the things that God provides, they come fresh every day. And it is an everyday occurrence. And I have to remind myself that His providence is in control of this day. I need to choose wisely what I do in His economy. You need to choose wisely what you do in His economy. He is the final judge, as we've discussed. There will be a day that every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. And because we know that everything under the heavens, under the earth, and the universe, everything, God knows what's going on. Because of that, it should humble us to not only be looking at some of the Proverbs and how the wise sayings help us to see a wonderful picture of God. Hello? 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 I have hibiscus in my backyard. If you've ever been to my house, if you haven't been, come over sometime. Just drop by. Not all at once. Yeah, not today. You might get really wet. But I have hibiscus in my backyard, and they're just awesome. Because they put on this big, beautiful flower. And I love hibiscus. And no, I don't want one for my birthday or Christmas. I just love hibiscus. And we try, and our goal every year is to see if we can nurse them through the winter so they'll come back the next year. Some do, some don't. But I love them, and there's something very unique about the hibiscus. That its flower opens up in one day. And in the 24 hours, it looks like this. And it just falls off. But the next day, there's another one. Sometimes bigger and more beautiful, sometimes smaller and more intricately designed by God in its beauty. There are double blooms. If you knew that about hibiscus, or hibiscus that blooms inside of a hibiscus flower. Beautiful. They too only last a day. Every day I like going out during the time when they're growing. I like going out and seeing new flowers every day. And that reminds me of what God wants to do every day in my life. Amen. Do something beautiful. And it lasts for this day. He's done something for all of us who've accepted Jesus Christ that lasts all the way into eternity and beyond. But here on earth, we need to be reminded that God wants to be doing great things through us all the time. He wants to be doing it daily. He wants you to be making right choices. You remember the first message I preached on this. You do what's right, and you leave the rest to God. That's His providence. Well, as I think about those flowers, sometimes we encounter various and different things in our life. 2 weeks ago, we talked about a coach and a scepter and talked about people that God was training up to do a great thing. We talked about Joseph and Esther and King David, and we talked about how God was training them up. Last week, we talked about Nebuchadnezzar. That's where God has control even of the things that aren't claiming Him. The pagan things of this world, those things that would stand diametrically opposed to Him, God still is sovereign, and His providence covers even those. And we talked about that in Nebuchadnezzar and how he knelt down and acknowledged not his greatness, but the greatness of the God of Daniel. This week, I want to talk to you about those people who have gone through the training and then have to face and encounter those hard things that seem to be perpetual, where people are against them. One of the tragedies of our world today is there's a lot of things that are going wrong, and a lot of things are going wrong in the family. And often, moms and dads and grandparents aren't willing to say that's wrong and make a stand for what's right, because they're afraid of causing difficulty in the family. Jesus had some comments about that in the New Testament, but we're going to look at the Old Testament. He said the truth that's being presented, it's going to divide families because you know what's right according to my word. And because you know what's right, for you to remain silent about those things, you think that it's good for the family. You think that it's good for just keeping the peace. But the problem is when there's sin, there is no peace. And when you leave sin undone, guess what happens? It just gets worse. Why you think that it's okay, and I know some of you will pull out as we walk out the door, you pull out the passage, and the Bible says, be at peace. Be at peace. Best you can, be at peace. Yeah, but the problem with it is, when there's sin, there is no peace. And I'm not saying you need to go out and kill everybody that's sinning. You'd have to start with yourself. But what I am saying is, there are going to be times that Christians have to stand up and do what God said to do, whether they like it or not. And they need to do it, not because I say so, but because God's Word gives us pictures of it in the Old Testament. He gives us pictures of it in the New Testament. He gives us pictures of it even today. There are so many people that could have so many things to be able to say, thank you, Lord, because you helped me be faithful all of these years. But instead they have to say, oh, why didn't I say something years ago to my kids or to my friends or to those I knew who were in sin and now are going through so much difficulty and turmoil in their life? Why didn't I say something back then? And we have to deal with the consequences of not only their sin, but ours in not being faithful in providential things of God saying no. Doesn't mean we have to be a killjoy. Doesn't mean we have to be Mr. Judge with the Bible walking around hitting people in the head with the Bible. It doesn't mean that we need to have a big Bible so we can hurt them bad. It does mean, though, let your yes be yes and your no be no, and the Bible tells us that. If it's wrong, don't say maybe. Or for right now, no, I can love you, but I can also tell you that it's wrong. We see this when we see Moses. He's already been giving his orders. We preached on him about 3 weeks ago. He's been giving his orders on what to do. He's going, and he gets to Pharaoh, and my goodness, the people that he's come to rescue hate him. Could you imagine God telling you to go rescue people that hate you? You're like, yeah, God, let me go do that. I'll volunteer for that one. He gets there and he talks to Pharaoh and says, hey, let God's people go so that they go out in the wilderness and worship. And Pharaoh says, no. And Pharaoh then turns around and says, I want you to make bricks. The bricks that you've been making, but now I'm not going to give you any straw. You've got to go find it for yourself. So now you've got to keep up your quota and you've got to make bricks too, to the same quota. Well, that didn't go over so well with the people. In fact, let me invite your attention to Exodus chapter 5. Exodus chapter 5. I'll give you a few moments to turn there. I've kind of set the story up, and if you read the first part of it, and back into chapter 4, that's where God assigned Aaron, and he was going to be the spokesperson, and Moses was just going to go and hold the stick. In that message I preached, that's the last where I left him standing there holding the stick. Well, now we're looking a little bit further because now he gets there. He didn't want to talk and hold the stick. He just wanted to hold the stick, if you remember. And when he gets there, he does all the talking and he holds the stick. So when we pick this up, we pick it up in verse 20. They've already talked to Pharaoh, and it says, when they left Pharaoh's presence, they met Moses and Aaron. These are the people that, the Israelites, and they were waiting for them. Doesn't that just smack of some kind of hate? We're not happy with you? You see, they go and they visit with Pharaoh and say, why are you doing this? He says, because of what Moses did. So all the Israelites go, hey, let's go talk to Moses. What do you think you're doing? In verse 21, and notice, I love that, and they were waiting for him. Yeah. Yeah, you kind of want to do that, don't you? Bom, bom, bom. They said to him, may the Lord look upon you and judge you, for you have made us odious. That means stinky. In Pharaoh's sight and in the sight of his servants, to put a sword in their hand to kill us. Then Moses returned to the Lord and said, O Lord, why have you brought harm to this people? Why did you ever send me? Ever since I came to Pharaoh to speak in your name, he has done harm to this people, and you have not delivered your people at all. You know, I got to tell you, the first thing you want to do is when God's got you doing something, is believe that he can do it. The worst thing you can do is say, what are you doing? How many times when we encounter a little bit of difficulty in our life, the first thing we say, Lord, what are you doing? Lord, I know it says this, but why would you want me to say something like that to somebody else? Why would you want me to say what's right? Because all it's going to do is bring difficulty to them. You know, that's probably one of the reasons why we've kept our mouths shut as Christians. We don't want to complicate anything for anybody. It's not about complicating things. It's about living in the sovereignty of God. It's about understanding His providence and knowing that when He says open your mouth and speak, it means open your mouth and speak. And it may mean that somebody's not going to like you, love them anyway. You notice Moses doesn't just hate the people at this point. He's still actually speaking on behalf of the people before God. But he's also saying, why did you send me? A little bit later, God reminds him he's got the stick. That's always good. As we see this, though, we see that God is setting all of this up so that the people can see the deliverance of their God. Sometimes we have to stand in places we don't want to stand, and we're afraid to stand there, but God says, stand there because I'm about to do something big. And if you'll stand there, you'll get to be a part of the testimony of the greatness of who I am, and if you choose to run away, you then will be the disgrace that didn't believe. You know, I think about that when I think about buildings. Not only buildings, but when it comes to testifying in our workplace, when it comes to working and walking around in our marketplace, when God says, speak, how often do we just swallow our tongue and move on? Or when we're having a conversation with a family member or with someone else who is in diametric opposition to God's Word, and we are prompted by the Spirit to open our mouth and say something, but what do? Our face implodes. We can't speak because we're so fearful. You know what? Part of that is believing in the God that you serve. If you serve yourself, you'll be worried about what you look like, and that means you're still God on the throne, not God. That means you're still claiming your right to govern your own life. You may be saying, well, He wants us to govern our own lives. He wants us to do that. He wants us to do that in light of the greatness of who He is. He wants us to bring glory to Him because He's worthy. You may say, that just sounds egotistical. That just sounds selfish of God. Hang on. When you say that, what you're doing is you're comparing yourself to God, saying that you can judge Him whether He's egotistical or not. I don't want to be in your shoes. Did you pay attention to the thunderstorm last night? That says, oh, you're just egotistical, God. That might not wash real well with Him. I'd be careful about that. God is setting them up so that He can show Moses, and not only Moses, but the people, that He has the capability to deliver even when it seems hopeless. You ever been hopeless before? Ever been there? Didn't think you'd see the light of day? Yet here you are. And when you look back on that, you can see how God's hand moved you, protected you in some places, guided you, pushed you in some places. And then you come to a place where you can look back on it and say, thank you. Why do you think in the Old Testament they recount the stories of Abraham and Moses and the promised land and the conquest? Why do you think they recount those and they go back to those stories? Because God says, I want to display to you that I can deliver you. As long as you don't believe that God can deliver you, you are still being God of your own life. Because you're judging God and saying, He can't. Sometimes it means, though, that we have to go and do and believe in Him no matter what the rest of the world says. I have a feeling that this is going to become more and more and more egregious in our day and in our time, where people are going to force you to be able to talk about your God, and they're going to compare their thought processes and their gods to your God. And I got to tell you, if you don't know your God well enough to believe in Him, you'll lose every time. Because then they're not fighting with God, they're fighting with you. You better make sure who your God is. God does. In fact, in this story, God tells them, okay, I want you to go. And got that stick in your hand? If you keep reading, you'll see God says, you got the stick in your hand? Let me go tell you. And He gives them a whole course of what takes place. And of course, all of the plagues come in. And even to the ultimate one of the firstborn child dying, what we understand, what's in Jewish heritage and tradition, and what took place as a thing called Passover. And we see God's hand. We still even celebrate to some degree when we celebrate Easter, when we celebrate the Lord's Supper, when we celebrate those things that remind us of the greatness of God. And we celebrate those things, and as we celebrate them, it's a reminder that God did it. He's the one that delivers us. Every time I think I've delivered myself from something, I'm only in a bigger mess. Do you live in the same world I live in? But when I give it to God, God says, I got this. I can handle it. So we see, and he wants his people to see him as a deliverer. My question to you is he your deliverer? We know that he delivered us from sin when we accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, but is that all he can do? I got to tell you, it's enough. But he's a bigger God than that. He's even bigger than that. And Jesus knows it well. As a part of the Trinity, we see that in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The second place that I see is in Exodus 15, just a few chapters later. This is still Moses. And in chapter 15, verses 22 through 25, there's a picture here that the people aren't seeing, but God wants them to see this picture. And sometimes the difficulties that we go through, and when we're leading others and trying to help them, sometimes they come back to you and say, it didn't work the way you said it would, and all you can say is, wait on the Lord. Sometimes people don't like to hear that, wait on the Lord, do they? They're like, no, you said, well, as long as you're only going by what I said, my words will always fail you. But God's words never fail.
Amen.
And part of it is you believing that and knowing that in your own heart. The second thing that we see here is when they come on some bad water in Exodus chapter 15, verse 22 through 25. Verse 22, it says, then Moses led Israel from the Red Sea. They've already seen the parting of the water. Yay! Pharaoh's armies drowned. Yay! It says, and they went out into the wilderness of Shur, and they went 3 days into the wilderness and found no water. When they came to Marah, they could not drink the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. Therefore, it was named Marah. So the people grumbled at Moses, saying, what shall we drink? And he cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree, and he threw it into the water, and the water became sweet. There he made for them a statute and regulation, and there he tested them. You see, they had lived in the dependence of Egypt all these years, some 300 years since Joseph. They had lived in the protection of Egypt, and they come across a place where no longer is it good anymore. And God's trying to show them a picture. Egypt isn't going to work for you anymore. And so they come to this water, and it's bitter. How many times do they say, as they're traveling through the wilderness, I wish we'd stayed in Egypt? It would have been bitter water back there. Because you got to remember, when they left, they kind of pillaged Egypt just a little bit. Could you imagine going back to it, what the Egyptians might do to them if they came back? It probably wouldn't be real good. But they thought for some reason they could go back and everything would be as it was. Just like that water. That water, it looks like water, therefore it should be good water. No, 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 it's bitter water. And the people come to Moses. You know, they don't cry out to God. God, why is this bitter water? No. They go to Moses. He brought us out here in the wilderness to watch us die of thirst. You know, sometimes God takes us out of the wilderness and he lets us get awful thirsty. And then when we stop blaming everything else that's around us and start saying, Lord, what are you trying to teach me here? And he reveals it. It's just like fresh springs of water. And Jesus, or Moses, goes and God says, go get that stick over there. Another stick! It's a branch, really, is what it says. But he says, take that branch and put it in the water. Stir it around a little bit. It'll make it good. So Moses, once again, takes a stick. He sticks it in the water. Swirls it around. Over 1 million people get to drink from that. Must have been a big branch. A big stick. But it was to show that even though the bitterness of Egypt was back there, God had something better for them going with it. You see, see, God was showing him that he was the healer. All the things that had taken place in Egypt, God was the healer of all that. He made the bitterness of the slavery, of the incarceration. He was making them into a nation. And no longer did they have to suffer under the bitterness. No longer did they have to worry about trying to go back. They could know that he could heal them right there, on the spot. You see, this is one of the first encounters, other than the Red Sea, this is one of the first encounters that we see where the people come to Moses and doesn't have to do anything with Pharaoh or Egypt or anything like that, and he's able to teach them a lesson about the greatness of their God. In the middle of the wilderness, when you come across bitter water, God is the healer that can heal you of all the bitterness of the past. We have to trust Him. So we see the bad water in Exodus 15:22-25. In Exodus 17, just a couple chapters later, you'll never guess what they've got a problem with again. San Antonio probably going to have no water problems for a while. Thank you, Lord, and I say that with all seriousness. But in verse 1, chapter 17, and all the congregation of the sons of Israel journeyed by stages from the wilderness of Sin, according to the command of the Lord, encamped at Rephidim, and there was no water for the people to drink. Therefore the people quarreled with Moses. Once again, the people are mad at. There you go. And Moses said, give us water that we may drink. And Moses said to them, why do you quarrel with me? You see, can you see a little bit of frustration there? Yeah. You know, that's like somebody coming and saying, why is my life so bad? Have you asked God? No, I want you to tell me. Really? Why do you want to contend with me? If you want to fight, go fight with Him. That's one of the reasons why I believe He can't fix people. God fixes people.
Amen.
We have to speak His truth. In verse 7, but the people thirsted there for water, and they grumbled against God. Nope. Say it with me. Moses. Grumbled against Moses and said, why now have you brought us up from Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst? So Moses cried out to the Lord, saying, what shall I do to this people? A little more, and they will stone me. You ever felt like somebody's just going to beat you up or hurt you bad because you're still doing what God wants you to do? You ever felt that way? I would say to you, this message is about continuing on no matter what anybody else does. You continue doing what God said. There may be people along the way that don't agree with you, but you keep doing what God said to do, loving them, and caring for him. He's now fearful for his life, saying, God, you know, he's probably wishing he hadn't picked up a stick. Either of the sticks. Because they're not paying attention to the sticks. And in verse 5, and the Lord said to Moses, pass before the people and take with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand your staff with which you struck the Nile, the stick again. And go. Behold, I will stand before you, and there on the rock at Horeb, you shall strike the rock, and water will come out of it, that the people may drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. You know what happened? Water. Water. Because of that, we see once again, Moses saying, God, why did you have me out here? They're ready to stone me. And God says, Moses, calm down. I'll provide. So we see in this, first of all, I'll deliver you. I'm your healer. And I'll provide. When you're in your worst circumstance, aren't those the things that you're looking for? You're looking for answers. And God says, I'll do that. Give it to me. We don't like to give things to God so easily. Because we want to think that we've got better sense than God. Time and time again, though, that proves to be not true. God has more than we could ever think. So, when we see all of these things, and we see He's our deliverer, He's our healer, He's our provider, But then we just come to a point where we just get really egregious with God. I'm the only one. Poor me. No one knows my problems. I always love when people, when Christians come to me and say, Pastor, you just don't understand. Do I have to understand what God understands? When you say, you don't understand, you're looking for me to have sympathy and compassion upon you, and I try to do my best, as best I can, but the one you need to be crying out to is not me. And you may be saying, yes, but you're supposed to be an encourager. I hope I do that every Sunday. I hope I encourage you to do the things God calls you to do. I hope that when you come to me, I'm giving you biblical counsel. I hope and pray that as we talk together, that I'm pointing you back to Jesus and back to His Word. If I'm not doing those things, you need to find a new pastor. And you may be saying, but that's not the kind of encouragement I want. Then you might want to call Dr. Oz or one of those other idiots on television and just get whatever counsel you want from him. I have nothing against the man. I have to say that because it's going to be on the internet. Everybody will be going, oh. I'm talking about just poor counsel. That's what you want. The Bible says that that day will come when God's people will seek those who will scratch their itching ears. Is that what you want? I would hope not. But when we come to this place, we find Moses, and if you look over Numbers, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and yes, I'm coming very quickly to a close in this message, but I want you to see that as this progresses along, that Moses comes to that place that many of us are, oh my goodness, could it get any worse? I'm the only one, and it's so bad. And you would think, wow, I felt that way before. I want to give you some counsel from God's Word about that. In Numbers chapter 11. In verse 11, I'd like to start. I encourage you to read 10, but 11. So Moses said to the Lord, why have you been so hard on your servant? Not servants. Servant. Me. And why have I not found favor in your sight that you have laid the burden of all this people on me? Lord, it's just so heavy. Verse 13. Where am I to get meat to give to all this people? I just want to deal with his questions. Who am I that I'm supposed to get all this meat? In verse 13 or 14, I alone am not able to carry all this people because it is too burdensome to me. You know what God's trying to teach him right there? You're not carrying them. I am. Who provided the water? Who provided the healing? Who provided deliverance? Moses is kind of thick about this point. In verse 15, though, this is probably the most, this is the pinnacle of it right here. So, if you're going to deal thus with me, please kill me at once. If I have found favor in your sight, and do not let me see my wretchedness. Just kill me. Just kill me. Lord, just take me home. My life is just so miserable. Just kill me. Nobody in this room has ever felt that way ever in your life. I'm sure. In verse 16, the Lord says to Moses, gather for me 70. And when he says, I want you to get 70, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to spread this burden out over the 70. And we're just going to see how that works out. But I want to bring you a little bit further into this in verse 19. And he says, I'm going to provide food for you. In verse 19, it says, you shall not eat one day, nor 2 days, nor 5 days, nor 10 days, not 20 days, but a whole month until it comes out of your nostrils and becomes loathsome to you because you have rejected the Lord who is among you and have wept before Him saying, why did we ever leave Egypt? But Moses said to the people among whom I am, are 600,000 on foot, yet you have said, I will give them meat so that they may eat for a whole month. Should the flocks and the herds be slaughtered for them to be sufficient for them? Or should all the fish of the sea be gathered together for them to be sufficient for them? You see, God was saying, I'm going to give you food. I'm going to feed them not only for 2 days, 3 days, 4 days. I'm going to feed them for a month. Yay! And you know what Moses' response back to God was? Even if we killed all the cattle, even if we caught all the fish in the sea, there wouldn't be enough food for these people. That's really believing in your God. Verse 23 is where I really want you to just really focus for a minute. The Lord said to Moses, is the Lord's power limited? Now you shall see whether my word will come true for you or not. God could, I don't want God ever to ask me that question. So Jack, you just think that my power is limited, do you? Well, put your name in there. Because when we say it's hopeless, it can't happen. That's what Moses was saying. It's hopeless, it can't happen. Even if we slaughtered all the animals, even if all the fish in the sea were gone, we still wouldn't have enough. You say you're going to feed us for 30 days. Ha! And God says, do you think I don't have the power to do that? There's a club in golf. It's a one iron. You won't find many golfers who carry a one iron. The reason you won't find many golfers who carry a one iron is because most golfers will agree that only God could hit a one iron. And we're not talking about striking a golf ball. We're talking about a lightning bolt. That was a joke. I have no golf. Okay. Just be sure. God's power isn't limited, I guess is what I'm trying to say. God can hit one iron. Nobody else can, but God can. And He can do it quite efficiently. You don't trust me? You don't believe I can? Really? You know, when we get to thinking our life is so miserable and so mundane and so hopeless and everything like that, God says, you really don't think I have the power to do anything about what's going on in your life? There was someone else who did this, and I'm closing with this, Elijah. And you can look over in Kings chapter 19. Just put that in the margin of your Bible. Because where Moses comes and he asks this question, and you think you can do it, and God says, my power is unlimited. I got all kind of power. Elijah did that as well. And in 1 Kings chapter 19, just mark it in the margin of your Bible. Let's go and read it later. Because it's an awesome read. He's just killed 450 prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel. God has taken the sacrifice that He offered up to him and did it in a dramatic fashion. And then the queen, Jezebel, who's a pagan queen, says, I want your life. And for some reason, Elijah, who just stood on Mount Carmel, had 450 of her prophets killed, had this spectacular display of God's power. And now all of a sudden he's going, oh my goodness, my life is over. He says in verse 9 of that chapter, I'm just hit the highlights of this. In that verse 9, at the end of it, God asked him, what are you doing here, Elijah? God has taken care of him, brought him to a cave. He's inside the cave. God's ministering to him. The angels are ministering to him. All these kind of things. And God says, what are you doing here? And notice what he says to God. He said, I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the sons of Israel, have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword, and I alone am left, and they seek my life to take it away. Sounds kind of like Moses, doesn't it? Yeah. So we have a little corollary there in that. We can see the two of them. Okay, good God, I'm the same. I only won, and why'd you do this to me, and everything like that. God says, hey, come outside, I want to show you something. And three huge, catastrophic events take place. But Elijah stays in the cave. He doesn't want to come out. And each one of these events that take place, this magnificent display of the power of God, the Bible says, but that wasn't God. That was just power. It wasn't God that was, God allowed those things to happen, but it wasn't God having to lift the finger to do them because He's God. And he calls on things that he's created to show. Elijah sits in the cave, and finally a still small voice comes to him and says, kid. And a lot of preachers preach that like, poor Elijah. I'm like, no, no, no. Elijah, the Bible says he covered his face with his mantle, and some preachers would say, oh, that was him just being reverent toward God. What a little kid does? Fine. Say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I see that because here's why I say that. Because even when God says, get up, I have something to show you, he covers his face, and God says, what are you doing here, Elijah? And you know what Elijah says? Lord, I am so sorry. I should have listened to you. You are God Almighty, and I know that. And I want to just reverence you and drop down in fear of you and honor you and praise you. That is not what Elijah does. When God says, what are you doing here? Even after God displayed all of those things that Elijah chose to ignore. By the way, it's not good to ignore God. It's just saying. Then he responds back to him in verse 13, or God asks him in verse 13, what are you doing here, Elijah? And in verse 14, remember it was in 10 earlier, but in verse 14 he said, I have been very zealous for the Lord. This guy's got it memorized. You know, I've taught Sunday school for 42 years. I've done this, I've done that, and everybody's forsaken you. And I mean, he has it down. He's got his whole story ready for God. And he says this thing, same thing he said earlier. I've been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the sons of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. That's what he had done just a few days earlier to the pagans. But he's saying that's what they've done to him. Anyway, and I alone am left, and they seek my life to take it away. If you continue reading in verse 15, God says, I want you to go down and I want you to anoint me a couple of new kings. And while you're at it, I want you to anoint me a new prophet. I want you to anoint me a new prophet. I hope and pray that as I've watched God deliver, as I watched Him heal, as I watched Him provide, I hope that as you watch those things in your life, that there'll never be a day that you would question the awesomeness of God, and that you would always be confident in who God is in your life because of faith in Him. I would hope you'd be confident enough where there'd never be a day where God would say, hey, let me show you my mighty stuff, and you say, oh Lord, I've been zealous for you, and it just ain't working out, and they've killed everybody, I'm the only one left. And God would say to you, listen, I need you to come out because I need somebody else to do what you're supposed to be doing. Would you really want to be replaced like that? I wouldn't. I would rather be faithful to the Lord and know He's going to accomplish something great. Now, Elisha came on the scene and did greater things than Elijah. That's awesome. And after that day in the cave, Elijah still did some great things. That's awesome too. The point of it is, I never want there to be a day where God says, I've got to use somebody else because you won't do what I've asked you to do. I never want to be at that place in my life. I would rather be the one that says, Lord, I'll do what you want me to do. I would hope that you would choose that because you're understanding more and more about the providence of God. That He's in charge. And He's our sovereign. He's our Lord. And we should live our lives in such ways. Today there may be somebody who's never accepted Jesus Christ. You may be operating in the mercy of God. And understand that you have the opportunity to live in that mercy because God affords each day, each breath you breathe, He's given it to you. You may need, have never experienced the grace of God through the Son of Jesus Christ. That's why He's given His mercy, so that you have an opportunity to respond to His grace. What a wonderful thing to do this day. Christian, you may be like Moses. Oh, everything is just so hard and so terrible. And Lord, why is this happening to me? Folks, we're falling into some really hard times. And I promise you, not because my promises are any good, but the Bible tells us it's going to get worse. And I'm not a doomer and gloomer because I know who wins in the end, don't you?
Amen.
But Christians, we need to be faithful to what God's called us to do. We've got to be faithful to Him because in the end, He wins.
Amen.
And if we're with Him, we win because of Him.
Amen.
Awesome. Would you stand with me?